Hello, I'd like to talk to you about the Long Man of Wilmington, which is this figure of a man on the north-facing side of the South Downs, not far from Eastbourne and Lewes in Sussex. And I'm also going to describe a walk around the area. It's quite a long walk, about 10 miles, but it takes you past the Long Man on several occasions, gives you the opportunity to observe it and also to explore the surrounding area and get a little bit of an idea of the historical context. So this is an overview of the route of the walk. It begins and finishes in the village of Alfriston, which itself is a very old village on the River Cookmere. And it's a vague figure of eight shape that passes the Long Man three times. Once at a distance, which is actually the best perspective to see the Long Man, and twice it passes beneath the feet of the Long Man and gives you a close-up view of him. Now, the Long Man of Wilmington is a perfect example of what you might call the malleability of history. If you're familiar with him at all, you probably think of the figure as a chalk carving, probably dating back to the Neolithic period, at the very least to the early Iron Age. And in thinking that way, you're probably comparing it to a couple of other notable chalk figures that exist in England. The closest parallel being the Cerne Abbas giant. The Cerne Abbas giant is a chalk carving in Dorset, not far from Dorchester, which for obvious reasons has been associated with fertility rites. And there is also another famous chalk carving in Berkshire or Oxfordshire, which is the White Horse of Uffington. So this is an image of the White Horse of Uffington, and of the three figures, this is the only one that archaeologists have proved conclusively does date back to the Late Bronze Age, early Iron Age. There's a little bit less certainty about the Cerne Abbas giant, but it's important to note, I think, that both the Cerne Abbas giant and this white horse are both on hillsides beneath enclosures, early enclosures or settlements. But that isn't actually the case with the Long Man of Wilmington. Fairly close to him on the hilltop is a Neolithic barrow or burial mound, and that has tempted some people to assume that the Long Man does date from that period. But archaeologically speaking, there has never been any proof that this figure even dates back to the Middle Ages, let alone earlier. And even more damning than that is the fact that although it looks like a chalk carving, this figure was never and has never been a chalk carving. Originally, it was simply an outline of a figure formed by indentations in the grass, and the grass took on a different colour, so it could be seen in the autumn, for instance, or the early summer. And the figure was once known as the Green Man rather than the Long Man of Wilmington, sometimes also known as the Wilmington Giant. But the point is, it's not, even though it's on a chalk slope, it isn't a chalk figure. It started life as just an indentation in the grass. That would be apparent in seasons when the grass changed colour. It might also be apparent if there's, for instance, had been a light snowfall. But it wasn't chalk. And the reason it doesn't date back any earlier than the Middle Ages is that if you look at the slope there, you'll notice there's a lot of slippage of the ground. The soil isn't stable there, and the last time that the soil shifted dramatically was around the 15th century, I believe. So had there been a figure there before that, it would have been obliterated by the slippage. So although there's no archaeological dating of the figure, there is a strong indication that it couldn't possibly have existed before the before the late Middle Ages. The reason that nowadays it appears to be a chalk figure is that in the 1870s, the Victorians decided to try and restore the figure, and believing it to have once been a chalk carving, they attempted to dig down to the chalk surface and found that too difficult. Incidentally, the White Horse of Uffington was created using that technique. It's formed of 2 foot deep trenches that have then been backfilled with compressed chalk, so that the trenches have actually been filled with this impacted chalk material, which gives it a very permanent and definite outline in the ground. But the Victorians found it much too difficult to dig down to where the chalk was, and instead used yellow bricks to outline what they thought was the outline of the figure. And in fact, they made some significant changes to the figure when they did so. The feet, for instance, were originally pointing downwards so that it appeared as though the long man was walking down the hill. And instead of holding what appeared to be two staves, they were in fact more like agricultural implements, such as something like a sickle, something of that kind. And he also may have had some kind of headgear, like a hat or a helmet. So the Victorians, sort of in restoring the figure, drastically redesigned it, as it were, and they gave it this yellow brick appearance, which was again replaced in 1965 by brick blocks, which were then painted white. So far from being chalk, I'm afraid it's far more prosaic brick block, modern day brick block. So that does then beg the question, when and why was the Long Man of Wilmington created? Wilmington itself, which is very close by, once had a priory, and it's been suggested that the monks of the priory created the figure in the 13th or 14th centuries, but most people have dropped that idea because it's highly unlikely that religious monks would create the naked figure of a man in that way, even though he's without his genitalia, like the Cernabis giant. It's still unlikely that the monks would have portrayed a naked figure. The earliest known historical record of the Long Man is actually As late as 1710, there was a drawing found in the collections of the Dukes of Devonshire in Chatsworth House, which portrays the figure. And I personally think that is significant because the Dukes of Devonshire actually owned this land and passed it over to the Sussex Archaeological Trust in 1925. And the earldom of Devonshire wasn't created until the Jacobean period. The first Duke of Devonshire was only created at the time of William of Orange at the end of the 17th century. So my own personal feeling, because this would have taken some considerable effort to create, was that it was done at the behest of the Earls of Devonshire, which would place it at the very earliest at the beginning of the 17th century. It's on a site which you'll see later has the most incredible views, even from the foot of the Long Man. So it could be seen from a great distance, and it's actually been designed so that if you were to look at it from the air, it's actually an elongated figure. It only appears to be lifelike in terms of its proportions from a distance. So it would have taken a great deal of labour, a great deal of skill, and could only really have been done with the knowledge of the landowner. So I think personally it dates from that period. Why it was created is another matter, and I wouldn't like to speculate on that. The possibilities are that it was just a sort of antiquarian interest, the desire to create the pretense of one of these figures on the slope, or possibly there was a religious motivation behind it. It's unlikely now that we'll ever know, or even indeed know, what its original appearance was, what those implements were that it was holding in its hand, what it was supposed to symbolize. But having said all that, it's still of historic importance. It dates back about 400 years, and it's under the protection of the Sussex Archaeological Trust, and deserves to be preserved. So the walk we're going to go on, the 10-mile walk, begins in Alfriston. There are two car parks in Alfriston opposite one another, a short stay and a long stay. And we are going to go up this road here to the central area of Alfriston, which is a triangular area where there's a bus stop and a sort of medieval pillar stroke cross. And just after passing that, we're going to turn left down River Lane, which you can see on this map here. That brings you out into a sort of meadow area. We turn right there and cross over a white footbridge, and then turn left and follow the Cookmere River up to a red brick bridge. So here's the triangular area I was talking about with the bus stop, and just beyond that is River Lane. We go up there, and at the end there you can see the meadow. This is just looking back into the central square. We're actually on the official South Downs Way at this point. The river's just in front of us there. Turn right over that white footbridge and back down this way. And in the distance there, you'll see in a moment, we might just be able to make out a red brick bridge. Thank you. when you reach the bridge, cross the road, and just across to the right, you'll see another stile. You enter the field there and just pass diagonally over the fields, come out onto Lullington Road, and walk up the road for a short distance. So as you walk up Lullington Road, it's not far before you come to a stile on your in the hedge on your right hand side, and you want to go across there and then to begin to follow the footpath obliquely across a number of fields. So this is the spot opposite this house where you need to look out for the stile. Just coming up on the right here, there it is. You need to cross over there and then follow the path. Occasionally the path crosses a number of small lanes that lead down into Milton Street, and you just need to keep crossing them, keep going in a more or less straight line, and that will bring you out into a long stretch that crosses a number of fields and leads you towards the village of Wilmington itself. And you'll begin to gain a view of the Long Man of Wilmington just by looking to your right, and he's there on the slope of the downs. So as you can see, the path is well signposted and very easy to follow. And as you go along it, the Long Man becomes more and more apparent on your right hand side. Might be able to make him out there just on the side of the hill. And as you go along this path, that's the church at Wilmington there, and the remains of the priory in there somewhere as well. This is looking across at the South Downs, and the Long Man is on that slope just coming into view there. And it's along this path that you really do get the best views of the Long Man. As I say, it's deliberately designed to look correctly proportioned from this angle and at this distance. When you're up close, you get a very distorted view of the figure. The path is going to bring you out opposite a gate that leads into the churchyard of Wilmington Church, and you just cut through there, and as you emerge, you turn right, go up the road a short distance, and then on your left you'll see a sort of gap in the bank on the left-hand side of the road, with a signpost that leads you along a footpath that parallels the road, and will lead you all the way up slope to the base of the Long Man himself. So turn right here as you come out of the church and go up this road, and the footpath is on the other side of the road on the left. As you can see, there's a fairly obvious sign to guide you. Okay, so we're walking along this path, heading towards the Long Man, and we're going to turn right beneath him and go up a trail that you can just about make out there. And when we're just about where those trees are on the horizon, we're going to turn left during this circuit. And this is the view from the slope, looking out over the Weald. As you can see, even at this low level, we've got a fantastic view. It gets much better higher up. And the area the Long Man occupies is actually fenced off to discourage you from walking on it. There's a brief sign there giving you some details. It doesn't actually tell you when the earliest reference to the Long Man is. And as you can see, the view of him isn't as good from this angle. And unfortunately, you're nearly always looking into the sun as well, at least during the winter months. So now we're going to carry on past him, and these are some of the views that you get looking back to your right. I panned up into the sky here because it occurred to me that a lot of the Battle of Britain was fought over this area, and in fact the Long Man was painted green to prevent it becoming a guide for German bombers. Okay, so we're more or less now at the centre of that figure of eight trail we're going to follow. So the first time round, when we get to the top of the slope, we're going to turn left and then climb the hill. And then basically follow the South Downs Way, which isn't as obvious as it sounds, because the South Downs Way splits into various parts as you go along. But this is the trail that we're going to be following. So just at the top here, we're going to turn left and then follow the chalk track uphill. brings you out here. That's a view back towards Alfriston there. And we're going to turn left here, or go left here. And then a bit further on, the path forks, and we want to go to the right. So at this fork here, we don't follow that couple there. We're going around to the right and following that curving path. The fence on the left there is actually the top of the enclosed area that includes the Long Man. And this is the view you get to the right. So you're looking back at Alfriston there. And that's the Cookmere Valley there. And you get your first glimpse of the sea. And on your left, you then see this barrow, Neolithic barrow. I call them tumuluses, but I'm not sure that's the correct description. The presence of that barrow that's led some people to believe the Long Man is that age as well. So that's just a top-down view. It's worth pointing out that you can see where the trail that we took, the red track, takes a left-hand course in a moment. So we're following along that path there, and we're going to go up that sort of diagonal dark line there. Going to take a left-hand turn at this signpost here. The path we're following comes to a sort of wooded, small wooded area, and you just keep to the path and it takes you all the way down to a small place called Jevington, which is actually where we stopped for lunch. We had lunch in the churchyard in Jevington. When you come to the church, just turn into the churchyard. It's a very good place to stop and have lunch. They've got some benches there, a couple of benches that have a nice view And while we were there, we were actually entertained by a light aircraft doing acrobatics in the sky above us. After lunch, just go through this curious swiveling gate and out onto the main road, turn left at that point. And then up the road there, you can see the Eight Bells pub, which is another very good place to stop for lunch if you prefer. Otherwise, go straight on past it and a little bit further down after the pub, which you can see on the bottom of the map there. Is a lane called Green Lane, and you want to turn left into Green Lane, and then a little bit further up, look out for a left-hand turn, which is easily missed. So this is Green Lane. You want to go down here, and then a few, couple of hundred yards up on the right-hand side is the turning to the right. This is the turning you need to keep an eye out for, and this takes you on a path that leads across a couple of horse paddocks. This gives you an idea from the map that, again, it's a very easy path to follow.
I'm taking a picture of it in a minute.
And after that, the path takes you across a couple of short stretches of what I've described as wooded lane. So you've just got to turn right into them and then virtually straight away turn left out of them. And again, it's well signposted, so you can't really lose your way. I've marked on the map here a field where we saw some alpacas, but I've got some video footage of that, but they may not be there when you go by. Okay, now, after you've emerged from the second of the two wooded lane areas, you'll find yourself in quite a wide expanse of field, and you have to look across to your right and you'll notice a solitary post in the ground in the distance, which is indicating the path that you need to follow. So you head in that direction, and once you're past it, you begin to descend obliquely down a slope, and then there's a very well signposted and obvious path across the next field, which brings you to a sort of raised area between two fields, where you turn right and you walk along it until you come to the lane, and then you turn left down that lane, and when you reach the bottom of that lane, you cross the end of the road and follow uphill, quite a steep climb again, with Folkington Wood on your left hand side. So here's some film of that sequence coming up now. So there's the post in the distance, I'm just zooming in on it. Just see it there, centered in the middle of the image, and you head towards that. And then once you've gone past it, the path begins to descend, takes you to this gate, and then there's quite a steep descent down that field in front of you there. Here's the same map again. So at the moment we're at the spot that says descend slope. And then, having crossed the field, we reach the raised area between the two fields and turn right there along a grassed pathway between the two fields. And then when you reach this lane, you just turn left and proceed up the lane. And then when you reach this junction here, you want to carry straight on up this slope here that's just appearing. So you're now at the spot that says take slight left and climb slope, keeping wood on left, and that's Folkington Wood, and you walk along that for quite a long way. It's a sort of gradual climb, and it will bring you out onto the north facing side of the South Downs again, and you'll begin to get a good view over the Weald again on your right hand side. You're now on the red trail at the bottom there, travelling from right to left, and you're getting really good views across to your right, looking out across the A27 and the railway line beyond it. when you get to this spot, you want to turn left and go through that gate. And once you're through the gate, you come out into another open area, and you'll begin to see the Long Man of Wilmington facing you in the distance. So you're approaching the centre of the figure of eight again. And on your right hand side, you'll get views across to the village of Wilmington. This spot, you're going to travel along the same path that you used earlier, passing underneath the Long Man, but at the point where you turned left before, now you're going to carry straight on. This point, carry straight on up there. And when you reach this spot here, you're going to go right, follow the road round to the right, and that's going to lead you back towards Alfriston, which you can see in the distance there. And the chalk path that you're on descends the hill, and it reaches a road at the bottom, and you want to cross the road, carry on up the path a short distance further, but then rather than following it, you cut through a stile on the left in the hedge. So this is where the chalk path reaches the road, and you want to sort of carry on straight across there. And then before you go too far down it, you want to turn left here, and that will take you across a couple of fields. So at this point you're nearly back in Alfriston. Once you get to the end of the field path, you cut through the hedgerow there, and it brings you out on a narrow path that runs parallel with the hedge and takes you down to a private residence that you can just walk beside. That brings you out onto a road, and just across the other side of the road there's a sign showing you the footpath that will take you back to the white bridge that crosses the Cookmere that you crossed on the way out. So this is where the footpath just goes past the private house, and you just got to go through that gate at the end there, and it brings you out onto the road, and across the other side of the road you see the footpath sign there. You just cross the road and follow the sign. And there we are, you're back in Alfriston. You just have to retrace the steps you took earlier back to the car park. So there we are, I hope you've enjoyed that, and I hope I haven't disillusioned you too much about the antiquity of the Long Man of Wilmington. despite it probably not being that old, it's still a remarkable feature, and it's set in a fantastic setting, the surroundings of the South Downs, which I hope I've shown you are full of character and beauty, as well as a lot of historic interest in the way of the barrow and various Anglo-Saxon churches and old villages and so on. So thanks very much for watching. Please like, please subscribe, and hopefully I'll see you on the next video. Bye.